Welcome everybody to Mobility Mastery Monday Pop Q&A, where Stefan is going to ask me a question. It's a surprise. I don't know what he's going to ask me. We're going to see where the conversation leads and take you along for the ride.
Hey guys, this week's topic is why certain visceral memories come up when you're getting your fascia released. So I just want to go ahead and jump in and ask, like, I've had this experience before when I'm getting worked on by Alicia and when I'm getting fascial adhesions broken up, but a very intense memory from my past. Often it's something that I, like, consciously I wasn't aware of, but it will happen during a very intense, like, part of the work. So why do those memories kind of come back into our conscious awareness when we're getting stepped on?
Well, let me tell you.
Okay, go ahead and tell me.
Well, I guess I just want to preface all of this by saying, like, I can't tell you why they do from a scientific perspective. I can give my opinion.
Yes, let's blend a little woo-woo and science here and get the ball rolling, you know?
This is a huge topic. We could go all over the place with it. I love it. This is such a fascinating topic to me. I don't even know where to start. So,
do you want me to give an example of, like, what I mean by, like, when the first time you stepped on my, like, the first time you stepped on my IT van, would that help to kind of...
Well, why don't you tell them?
Get the ball rolling. Yeah, so one of the very first times Alicia stepped on me, period, I'm super tight naturally. She stepped on my IT band, a lot of adhesions in there, and it was extremely intense for me. And what started happening immediately was I was having these, like, visceral memories of suffering through the last few miles of the first marathon I ran, which is, I think, where I originally injured it. And here I am just kind of laying on the floor, groaning through this experience, trying to hold it together, and I'm having these intense visceral memories that are, like, really, that are just kind of taking me back to that place. And she, you know, she finished stepping on me and I kind of went, okay, what was that? So that's an example of what I'm talking about when I say, like, a very intense and visceral memory can come up sometimes. And it's something that, like, I had never thought about since the day that that happened. I'd never really associated that maybe that was the original injury there. But it can happen with, it may not even be associated to an injury, but that's an example of what I mean by visceral memory occurring when getting stepped on, separating a fascial adhesion.
Yeah, I guess, first of all, if you are finding this video and you have no idea what being stepped on even means,
you should probably explain that.
So I do a form of fascia release called kinetics, which is my own method of fascia release that involves me stepping on someone to compress a piece of the fascial system with my body weight and then coach people through movement. So it's active release for the fascia. The fascia, I mean, this is why I'm still not bored after 9 years working with fascia, because there's so much to learn about it. We're still learning a lot about it. Thankfully, it's starting to actually get scientifically studied now, and they're doing studies on different things. I know there are other people out there making the claim that fascia stores our long-term memory, that we store, you know, subconscious memories in there that we're not consciously aware of. I've definitely experienced this to be true in my practice. I've had a lot of people have emotional releases. Some of them know why they're crying and some don't. So some people end up getting stepped on and just start crying and they don't know why, but we don't need to know why. It's okay.
Sure.
So I guess, you know, my, as far as, like, why or what's happening, we've talked about this elsewhere if you've watched our video on fascia and the nervous system, so if you haven't, maybe check that out. We'll link to it below. But fascia is the most abundant tissue you have in the body, and it is the interface between our brain and everything else that the brain needs to contact in our body. So like it separates and connects everything. So it's kind of a communication network, but it's also a structure. It's a soft tissue structure, it's our webbing. It's also nerves travel through it, so blood travels through it. It's just an amazing substance to me. It's like, wow, what the heck is this? Because almost every other substance in the body has like kind of like one purpose, or it's kind of not maybe one purpose, right? But we know what blood is. Blood is, you know, X,
sure.
Y, and Z.
Tissues primarily do, like they serve a distinct primary function,
yeah,
like each
like
tissue does.
Muscle fiber, for example.
Mm-hmm.
But fascia is pretty unique, and we have various kinds of connective tissue or fascia. So fascia gives us our shape and texture. What gives our fascia its shape and texture is everything that's ever happened to us in our life. So that is everything good and everything bad. Every emotion we've ever felt has a physical sensation accompanying it that moves through the body, and that is felt on the nervous system level and potentially inscribed on the fascial system if it's not moved out of the body.
Mm-hmm.
So if anything that is not moved out of our system, I believe, gets stuck there, stored there, stuck there, imprinted
on the fascia.
On the fascia.
In this...
Yes.
Physical, tangible way.
Yes. So, I mean, the cool thing to me about this is that we don't need to go, like, hunting for all our memories.
Sure.
And recall them and feel them to move them out.
Right.
We can actually do that via the fascial system by feeling the physical sensation that maybe accompanied that memory. But not
sure.
necessarily the memory itself. But sometimes, yeah, those memories come up. So that is one reason why fascial release can be so intense, because we're actually accessing the stored physical sensations of the things we didn't fully process.
Hmm. And
I've never actually said that out loud before. That's a new one.
Are we going to have to quote you?
Do we need to write it down?
Yeah, we might. We'll come back and revisit it. So yeah, it's all very interesting. Like what I've been reading about, lately, that's very intimately tied to this is how fascia interacts with the other systems of our body.
Mm-hmm.
And I know like when we've talked about this, I guess maybe you can elaborate, but kind of our thoughts are that like it's through the nervous system that fascia and releasing fascia can have an impact on all the other systems. Like I read an article recently about fascia having an impact on the endocrine system. And you know, it was like a very well referenced article, but I think kind of what's missing, and maybe I'd like for you to comment on this, is how that's happening. So I don't know that the fascia interfaces directly with the endocrine system, but like how is it, what's happening with fascia that could be causing it to when it's released in particular to engage with all these other systems and cause changes in the hormonal system, and you know what I'm saying? Like how do all these different things happen?
So there are a lot of things at play when we're releasing fascia. We have to physically feel those sensations, and if you're in my office, and I believe this is one of the reasons why Kinetics is so fast, you never get sore from it. It lasts.
Well, I guess you can get sore from it if you're fighting.
Yeah, I guess,
but
yeah.
Rarely.
Yeah. If it's done well and everything is as it should be, you
sure.
typically don't get sore. It can happen. I don't like it to happen. excuse me. But it's because, okay, so physical sensation is happening.
Mm-hmm.
But then I'm asking you to move. So you're while under duress, for lack of a better word, it's intense, right? So there's a certain amount of confrontation of duress or stress happening. While under duress or stress, you have to perform a movement. So your brain has to turn on in a way that it normally doesn't or might typically avoid. Because we all have avoidance strategies for how to not do these things, not feel, you know, traumatized. So you have to then engage your brain-body connection. You have to, proprioception has to happen or nothing's going to happen.
Sure.
So, so for example, if I'm stepping on somebody and it's too intense that they can't move, I back off because they have to move. There has to be proprioception or nothing happens. So we're engaging brain-body connection. So physical sensation can, in and of itself, make your body, if it's perceiving a lot of pain, it'll release endorphins or painkillers, natural painkillers.
Sure.
Then, what's really interesting, if you're in my office and you're here for pain, and let's say you have back pain and it's at a 7 out of 10 level, and it's been that way for 5 years. If I just make you, you know, coach you through something and kind of push you through something really hard that you didn't even know you could get through, even though it was 20 to 30 seconds, because it is that intense sometimes. And you get up and your back pain is now a 2. Mm-hmm. You're just kind of like, holy shit. Like, I don't know, like it's a flood of like, oh my God, my pain has diminished. What just happened? So we've now interrupted a nervous system and a neurological pattern. We've interrupted a brain pattern. So now your brain has to reckon with what the hell is happening and create a new pathway potentially. But at the same time, I believe it's possible, this isn't with everybody, but it's possible that in some people who are engaging with fascia release in a certain way, that win of getting your pain from 7 to 2 and then hopefully to 0 creates another chemical release in your brain of dopamine and all the good, you know, chemicals that aren't just painkillers, but like the feel-good hormones, because you just did something hard to get a result and you like that result. So now your brain is going to want to wire you to do that again instead of doing the opposite, which is I'm going to avoid maybe the things that could help me, but then I'm going to be in pain all the time and I'm going to perceive that. And that's going to be the proprioceptive signal. So, I mean, and that's just a small portion of what's happening with fascia release. Sorry, you really got me going on this.
Yes.
So, at the same time, we're increasing blood flow immediately. Mm-hmm. So, now fresh blood is flowing through every system and what everything in the body needs, whatever system we're talking about, the muscle system, our bones, our cells, every single cell in the body, our organs need blood.
Sure.
Fresh blood, new blood. So by releasing fascia, we're getting new, fresh blood running through the body. And at the same time, suddenly you feel like buoyant and light, lighter. You feel lighter. Like we're so used to feeling dull and heavy and achy. And that is another really interesting feeling, and your brain has to make sense of it. And I don't know, I just think it's like, I think the overriding main thing is this, the ability of this work to interrupt brain patterns, which in and of itself can rewire us. Doesn't always.
Sure.
But often that's enough. So that in and of itself can create new hormones and signals, and your brain's going to start looking for something different.
Now, do you think it's similar to like something like, oh, at least in a certain sense, something like cold exposure, and that you're reckoning with this outside force that you have to stay present through in order to like realize benefit from it. Like if you're continually doing cold exposure and you're just you're never going to be able to, you know, warm yourself up, you're never going to acclimate to that on a meaningful level. And I guess I'm curious if like the same applies to this.
Maybe. I think there are some overlaps for sure. Mm-hmm. And I think there's some very distinct differences.
Yeah, I guess the reason I ask is because, like, you know, what they've shown, like Wim Hof method, what he was able to show is that, and they still haven't really addressed, at least to my knowledge, the mechanism by which this is happening, but changes are occurring in many different systems. But what I would love to hear more about, for many of you, if you have familiarity with this or experience in like some other kind of way, is I think the nervous system is likely moderating all of these changes in the other systems. And I think the same is true for fascial work. Like, do you think that that's how it's working?
I guess, I I guess I think that probably there's a higher likelihood, not a definitive, like not a for sure, right? But a higher likelihood of fascial work rewiring the brain faster,
mm-hmm.
Without having to endure as much adversity.
Sure.
And the reason I say that is, I don't know, like cold is, it is an outside force, and so is me stepping on you in a way, but what I, you know, believe is different between the two is I'm an outside force making you confront yourself.
Sure.
On a very visceral, physiological level inside, my experience with cold, like I know maybe some people experience the cold that way, but my experience with cold is my entire body is now surrounded, if I'm like submerged, right, or at least mm-hmm. most of me, in something very, very cold, and I break out in goosebumps, and my instinct is to start shivering or get out, right,
sure.
or hyperventilate, and so I'm like, okay, I'm like my practice in the cold is to actually just be calm, even though something really adverse is happening, and find a way to regulate my nervous system in that.
Mm-hmm.
That is wiring my brain to actually be okay with adversity.
Sure.
What I believe is happening with fascia release most of the time, it's not that. We could use it for that, but then it would be a totally different intent. So if I were to intentionally step on you, say, for a whole hour, and the point would be you need to find your zen and your quiet place and be really calm the whole time,
mm-hmm.
like, as you know, that's not what you do with me. What you do with me is very different from the cold. And there's a reason. So he's very vocal. getting stepped on.
Oh, yeah. I definitely, in my experience, as much, you know, and I don't know that I am like everyone else in this, but it's much easier for me to stay present in an ice cold bath for 20 minutes than it is for me to stay present through a kinetics session for 20 minutes. It's, and I think a lot of that is unique to my neurobiology, you know, just my story, but I guess it's just interesting to think about. One thing that I don't really experience in the cold, although I have experienced with breathing, just straight breathing techniques before, is these visceral memories that come up. And I think that because to me the difference is, it is somewhat what you described, but more than that maybe, is the fact that you're actually interfacing, like the cold is a force, but it's not a force like a human being is. And the fact that I'm interfacing with another human being that is intelligently addressing like where a fascial adhesion is in me, that could be a source of a lot of intensity for me, it's more confronting for me.
So, as I said, kinetics makes you confront yourself on a very visceral level that most of us don't do.
Right.
Like, it's very different than I'm going to do an ultra marathon.
And do you think that that's why memories are, like, they often come up, it's often why people will have emotional releases.
Yes.
When they're, whereas, you know, some other modality, it's not that it can't happen, it just may not be as
likely. Like it's literally a visceral, like, I'm going to push here, and oh yeah, that happened to me then, and I'm going to feel all the physical sensations accompanying it now.
Like, it's confronting, but in an intelligent and specific way.
Yeah, so for example, you guys, I have a theory that we actually hold the flight part of fight or flight, runs through our bodies and goes to our calves, probably calves and quads, but definitely calves. Like, and if we don't actually run and flee, it gets stored there, unless we like shake it out, you mm-hmm. know, which most of us don't. So whenever my calves are stepped on, it's the only body part that I don't enjoy. I legitimately actually enjoy almost every other body part getting stepped on, which is not normal, but I actually like it. I'm not just saying that. I actually am like, yeah, oh yes, let's get this. But when you step on my calves, I get sweaty palms. I like break out in like fear. I'm gonna hold my breath. I tense up. It's definitely like a fear response. So I believe I'm contacting all that unused fear and adrenaline.
Now, do you think that that's like that every person has a specific part of their, like you said, you thought generally, like that fight or flight, the flight part of that was rooted in the calves or potentially the quads. But like talking to you, it seems like everybody kind of has a different spot in their body, usually where a certain fear that evokes a survival, like fight or flight response manifests. And it's not necessarily in the quads or calves.
I think the calves are very indicative of a lot for most of us in when it comes to fight or flight.
Now, what about, I know you would say that's the majority. Now, for me, what you describe in the calves, that happens over pretty much my whole body. It's very systemic for me. And maybe you could comment on, like, what kind of clients you see that in. Typically, I know we've talked about like some of the autoimmune issues that you've encountered. Like, what are some other clients where you see some of these systemic fascial adhesions? And is there a different experience for those kinds of people when it comes to like visceral memories coming up through fascial release?
Probably the most obvious case I have, which you guys could also follow up on if you wanted to, would be my client Desiree, who love shallow Des. And she was brave enough to actually let us film a series of 10 sessions and put it on YouTube. But her story is pretty incredible. She broke her hip in a car accident when she was 19. She also had other stuff in her system, and I don't necessarily need to go into that, because I think the regular story will demonstrate it, but she broke her hip at 19, could not get a hip replacement surgery, which she needed because she was too young, and they don't do them at that age. So she had to just wait and play a waiting game until she could get a hip replacement surgery. She refused to let it stop her, though, and she became incredibly active. So she became very, very strong. She was determined not to let that define her life. So she became a wilderness therapy guide, ran marathons, climbed mountains, went backpacking, very active. But she blew her hip out being so active. So she climbed a 14er and that was it. And she couldn't walk for more than 10 minutes for 6 years. Imagine that. It's a hard thing.
I'd rather not.
Yeah. And then finally got word that she could get her hip replacement surgery. Got very excited, thinking, like, finally, I'm going to get my life back. Had the surgery, did the typical 6 months of PT, was still in exactly as much pain as she was before the surgery, like, no better. Tried acupuncture, tried a different physical therapist, tried chiropractic, tried massage, tried therapy, and she was still in pain. Finding me was kind of a last-ditch effort, and the whole filming and putting it on YouTube was kind of an agreement that, you know, she would try it if I could do this, I could put it on YouTube if she tried it with me, basically.
Right.
That was me bribing her a little bit. So she did, and the second session, in the first session, I was expecting, so it was her left hip that she had surgery on, and in the first session, I was totally expecting her right side to be tighter because it would have compensated all of these years from her left hip being broken, but her left appeared tighter during that first session. Then in that second session she came and I noticed her right actually finally like appeared tighter this time, which is interesting. But this is pure instinct on my part, and it's what's led me to working with the nervous system now, but I just looked at her and said, "You've had to be really strong for a very long time. Do you think you could let go? Like, you're going to need to let go and let me in." And she left that session. She wasn't emotional, displayed no, there was no emoting going on in that session, but she came to her third session with me and said, or asked, is it normal that I left after last time and started bawling and I've been crying every day since, and it was a week? And I was like, yeah, sounds about right. And she cried for 6 weeks. So she, you know, like, it's not like a specific memory came up for her.
Everything that was unprocessed.
Yeah, like she had no choice but to be incredibly strong because she had a broken hip. So her choice was stay home and mope and, you know, be a victim of having a broken hip or live life anyway. Mm-hmm. And she lived life anyway, but then she paid the consequence for it and had to go 6 years of not walking or hiking or backpacking or running or doing anything that she loves.
Yeah.
And but she was also like determined not to be sad for herself. Like the car accident was actually her fault. And she just knew she had to wait for the hip replacement. So she was determined not to be a victim to it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's one of the things I love about her. But like, then she finally got her hip replacement. So this is very interesting to me. Like I don't know if it ties back to somehow the emotions getting trapped in the body, but this is more of a neuroscience thing. But I actually believe one of the main reasons she was still in pain, not the only one, but I think one of the main reasons she was still in pain after her hip replacement surgery, even though it went well, and like by the imaging and everything they told her, she shouldn't be in pain.
Mm-hmm.
But it's my opinion that the reason she was still in pain is that her brain was so used to perceiving pain, it didn't know how to not perceive it.
Sure.
And something had to change and interrupt that pattern. And what had to interrupt it for her was feeling everything she didn't get to feel because she had to be strong for so long.
Yeah. Makes a lot of sense.
Yeah. So, anyway.
We don't think about it,
But to tie it back to the fascia, I could feel that in her fascia. Her fascia was like, I'm going to be strong. I'm going to be tough. You're not going to get in.
Sure.
You know, and I'm like, okay, well, I can't help you unless you let me in.
Mm-hmm.
And so I've said this for years, but I believe our fascial system, like the way it's holding its shape and texture, is indicative of how we're living our life. So Des had no choice but to live her life being strong and pushing through. So then she had a choice. Now she had the surgery and she found me. Okay, I could keep doing that, but I'm probably gonna get the same thing I always got. Or I could let go.
Sure.
And actually feel it all. And when she let go emotionally, she let go factually.
Yeah, I mean, you can't separate the two.
And she got out of pain, started climbing mountains, got pregnant, had a baby, is doing awesome. So, yeah.
Shout out. I don't have anything else on this. Do you have anything else you want to add? Just how emotions get stored, why visceral memories come up when we're getting fascial work done?
Yeah, where I'm taking this work now, what really lights me up and I get so excited about is that I truly believe this type of work is a way for us to viscerally check in about how we're living our life. Have we moved everything out from the past? Because if we have, the fascial system will reflect that for sure. Mm-hmm. And if we haven't, it'll reflect that. And neither is right or wrong, but we get to see what is. And then when we see what it is, we have a choice. It gives us more freedom. So I'm using this work now with some people as a way to check in. How are you moving through life? Like, how on a daily basis, on a weekly basis? We're going to be doing this ongoing work. And I just think it's like so much more, for me personally, it feels more visceral and real than like kind of wondering about my life or thinking maybe I need to go see a therapist and then trying to talk my way around it,
mm-hmm.
or out of it when we don't even know what it is. But like our body does.
It's a long ass process.
The body doesn't lie. The body knows exactly what you've been through your entire life.
Right.
And you don't even need to remember it. So I guess that's the thing I would maybe like close this on is like, I don't believe we need to actually remember every bad thing that ever happened to us to heal.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think we need to sit in therapy for year after year after year talking about it, getting sad about it, feeling it. I think there's a place for therapy. I think I'm not trying to.
It's okay if that whatever that is needs to be acknowledged,
yeah.
But it doesn't. You don't have to go seek it out in order to heal.
No, I do. I truly believe we can rewire our brain, like rewire our brains when we work with a body. And if we rewire our brains, our emotions change, our states change, our ability, our resilience changes.
Mm-hmm.
We can move through life with new resilience for meeting adversity in ways we didn't have before, regardless of whatever we've been through. So, yeah.
Yeah. Just a few short sentences.
Yeah.
Great. Well, that's all I have. Any final thoughts?
I guess I'll leave it at that. Otherwise, we're going to be here all night. I could be.
We will be anyways. So.
Yeah. Wow, if you watched all that, whew, you should get a gold star on our board.
You know.
Anyway, thank you so much for watching. I would really love to hear from you guys on this one if you have experiences, thoughts, questions, criticisms, you know, like anything about relating emotion and the body and fashion and all that. Let's have a conversation. So please type your comments below. If you found this fascinating and you want to have a conversation with other people, then we think, you know, it'd be pretty cool if you would share that on social media, maybe give us a thumbs up here on YouTube. And if you liked this information and you want more of it, you can subscribe to our free newsletter, and we'll also email you when new episodes go out at mobilitymastery.com. And please subscribe here on YouTube as well. And I think that's it. So we will see you guys next time.
Bye, guys.